Hi, welcome. The Grower Pesticide Safety Course. This is Chapter 7, Pesticides and the Environment. Chapter 7 starts on page 79 of the manual. There are 23 slides in this presentation, so it will take us about 15 minutes to review. So let's get started. What will I learn? At the end of this lesson, you should be ready to identify and explain the four factors that determine environmental risk, describe processes that affect the fate of pesticides in the environment, describe actions you can take to prevent pesticide contamination of air, water, and soil, and describe actions you can take to protect bees from pesticide poisoning. Let's start with protecting air, water, and soil. How you use pesticides can affect the environment. You need to follow the labels, environmental precautions, and those will be under the precaution section on the pesticide label. A label will state the ways that the pesticide is harmful to the environment and then give you directions on how to prevent harm. Directions could include such things as leave a 1 meter buffer zone between the treated area and water. Don't apply to areas with steep slopes. Don't apply next to areas when bees are present. These are all examples of precaution statements. Now, let's look at the environmental risk. Each time you use a pesticide, there is some risk to the environment, and the degree of risk depends on four risk factors: persistence, mobility, non-target toxicity, and volume of use. Now, let's look at each one of these a little bit more. Persistence. How long does the pesticide remain active in the environment? And we've had some history on persistent pesticides. Examples include DDT, picloram, and atrazine. Mobility. This is how easily does the pesticide move away from the site? And it could move through air, water, or soil. Non-target toxicity. How toxic is the pesticide to species that are not the pests that you're trying to manage? Volume of use. How much of the pesticide is being used? Across Ontario, used on your farm, overall. So we put all these four factors together, we have an equation that represents environmental risk. Persistence, mobility, non-target toxicity, and volume of use. The lower any one of these factors, the lower the risk. Pesticide fate. What happens to a pesticide after it is applied? Pesticide's properties influence its fate, that is, how it reacts in the air, in the water, in sunlight, and soil, and how it reacts with microorganisms, plants, or animals. So it all depends on the pesticide's properties. The physical and chemical properties, we can list those as degradation, bioaccumulation, biomagnification, adsorption, absorption, and volatility. All physical and chemical properties of the pesticide. The natural processes that will affect the fate of the pesticide, that includes spray drift, vapor drift, surface runoff, leaching, soil erosion. And we'll look into each one of these in the next few slides. Degradation is the breakdown of pesticides into simpler and less toxic products. Pesticides are broken down through three processes. Microbial degradation, the breakdown of pesticides by microorganisms that live in the soil and use the pesticide as a food source. Chemical degradation, the chemical reactions that occur, pesticides and the chemicals in the environment, such as with water. And photodegradation is the breakdown of pesticides by sunlight. And pesticides react differently when exposed to sunlight. Sometimes they break down rapidly, and sometimes they break down so rapidly they have to be incorporated in the soil after you apply it to prevent some of the photo degradation that might happen. Yeah, here we go again. Microbial degradation, microorganisms use the pesticide as food. Chemical degradation, chemical reactions break down the pesticide. Photo degradation, sunlight breaks down the pesticide. The rate of breakdown is measured by half-life. DDT and picloram are persistent and have half-lives longer than a year. 2,4-D and atrazine are moderately persistent with half-lives of 2 to 3 weeks. So, half-life again measures the rate of degradation, the time it takes for one half of the pesticide to break down when it was released into the environment. Now, let's go on to bioaccumulation. Some pesticides have the ability to build up in fatty tissues in the body. These pesticides continue to build up after each exposure, and as they accumulate, the pesticides become increasingly harmful to your health. So here we have rat number one at the top, and he has build up some pesticides are staying in his body. He gets some more exposure, more pesticides accumulate, and eventually ending in death. Biomagnification. This is the ability of some pesticides to build up in the food chain. So we have little microorganisms that are contaminated with pesticides that get eaten by fish, and then the bigger fish eat the smaller fish, and then the ducks, loons eat the fish that are contaminated. So it's the movement of the pesticides indirectly through other food sources. Toxaphene is a pesticide, an insecticide actually, that is extremely persistent, and it bioaccumulates in fish. It was removed from use in Canada in 1974. Our next term is adsorption with a D, and this is the binding of pesticides to soil particles and other matter. So similar to paper clips sticking to a magnet, sometimes pesticides bind to soil particles. Absorption, and this is the movement of pesticides into plants or animals and structures such as soil and wood. And similar to water being absorbed up by a sponge, some pesticides will be absorbed. Some pesticides more susceptible to being a volatile pesticide. Pesticides change from liquids or solids into vapors, things you can't see when exposed to moisture, heat, and air. Volatility increases when temperatures are high and droplets are small. Examples are 2,4-D and dicamba. They're very volatile and will injure sensitive crops. So it's best if you know if you can pick a low volatility formulation. Choose a low volatile product. Now let's talk about dicamba a little bit more. Dicamba products have been reformulated to reduce their volatilization. In 1967, dicamba was sold as a DMA formulation salt, Bamvil. In 1983, dicamba was sold as a DGA formulation, less volatile, called Bamvil 2. Then in 2017, we have dicamba sold as Extendamax with vapor grip, a DGA salt with encapsulation, and Engenia, a BAPMA salt, so another type of formulation, also to reduce volatility. So we have made strides in trying to reduce some of these products' volatility by the formulation and the chemistry used to make them. So again, if you have a choice, it's best to use and buy the product with the least volatility. If you are spraying 2,4-D or dicamba next to sensitive crops, it's very important you try to minimize this drift. So these crops are sensitive to 2,4-D and dicamba: grapes, sweet potato, tobacco, pepper, tomato, watermelon. Also, cantaloupe, cucumber, peach, peanut, squash, broccoli, cabbage, kale, mustard, and turnip. So again, be very careful. Make sure that you are spraying so that the wind is blowing away from a sensitive crop. How do pesticides move with wind and water? Well, we have drift, surface runoff, leaching, and soil erosion as the four key factors. Let's talk a bit about drift. Vapor drift occurs when the wind moves pesticide vapors from the site of application. We've talked about that a bit under volatility. And spray drift occurs when the wind moves spray droplets from the site of application. It's also called particle drift. Surface runoff. Definition. Pesticides move with water over the soil surface. Pesticides move with water when they dissolve in water, so are soluble, or they might bind, be adsorbed to soil particles, and that move in the water. So that's happening with soil erosion. Factors that affect runoff. Slope of the land. You can imagine the higher the grade of the slope, more runoff. The soil type and texture. Moisture content of the soil. Crop residues on the soil surface would prevent some soil erosion. And rains or irrigation that happen after application, that's going to put you in a place where the pesticide will move off with the rain with the surface runoff. Reduce surface runoff. There are some things we can do. We can watch the weather. We can make sure we don't apply pesticides if rain is forecast within the next 12 hours. Don't irrigate immediately after pesticide application. Use adjuvants to stick the pesticide to plant surfaces, especially if that's recommended on the pesticide label. Do take a look. And then use no-till or minimum tillage to reduce that soil erosion. Now we need to talk about leaching. Leaching occurs when pesticides are dissolved in water and they move through the soil. So movement may be downward, maybe upward to the side. Pesticides move into groundwater or to tile drains, going with the effect of leaching. Pesticides are more likely to leach, of course, through soils that are sandy or have a low water holding capacity. And two, when pesticides are persistent or soluble in water. Again, we're going to have more leaching those times. So when we're thinking about applying a pesticide, we have to take some of these things into consideration, and we can take actions to protect water. So Ontario has two laws. Use an anti-backflow device when you fill your equipment, so we don't want any backflow going into our water system. And another law, never wash equipment near surface water, ponds, streams, or creeks. So those are two things we can do, and those are in the Pesticides Act and Regulation 6309. Recently, we've had source protection plans in Ontario. So Ontario now has 22 source protection plans and the plans of actions that you must take to protect municipal drinking water. So this will depend on the watershed, and your municipality will know what watershed you're in. You may need to use specific buffer zones in addition to those on the label, or store and mix pesticides at specific distance from a well or drinking water intake. Again, it's your municipality you should contact. Now you can go online, look for the interactive source water protection map. And going onto that website, you can put in your address and you can see what restrictions for protection of water would be for your municipality. Protecting bees. All right. So we know that pesticides are harmful to people. We know that pesticides are harmful to bees as well. Beneficial insects, fish, birds, wildlife. And bees are important because they pollinate our tree fruits, small fruits, legumes, and other vegetables. They produce honey for us, and they can be poisoned by pesticides. They can be a poison through a direct exposure or indirect exposure, such as if the pollen they collect and store in the hive is contaminated with the pesticide. So there's some things we can do. Do not apply pesticides while fruit trees are in bloom. Follow label directions to protect bees. Apply pesticides after 8 p.m. when bees are not active. They've gone back to the hive. And your neighboring beekeepers. Tell your neighboring beekeepers when you plan to apply pesticides or when you plan to plant treated seeds. Reducing risk to pollinators from treated seed. In the springs of 2012 and 2013, residues of neonicotinoid insecticides, neonics, were found in 70 to 75% of dead bee samples that season. The neonic active ingredients include imidacloprid, thiamethoxam, and clofianindin. Anyway, the neonic treated seeds include seeds treated with products such as Poncho 600 FSC treatment, Cruiser 5SF seed treatment, Stress Shield 600, Aceleron 9409 insecticide seed treatment, and Cruiser Max beans seed treatment. So those are some of the products that we now have to have further pest management protocols that we have to follow when we're using neonic treated seeds in Ontario. We want to reduce our risk to pollinators from treated seeds. So bees could have been exposed in the dust generated during the planting of the neonicotinoid treated corn or soybean seeds. So you want to adjust your planter to reduce the dust. Mount air intakes for vacuum meters up high so that field dust does not enter the planter. Use dust reducing fluency agent and control the flowering weeds and plants around the field so bees are not in the area. And of course, we have the IPM course for corn and soybeans, and we now need to be certified to buy and use the neonicotinoid treated seeds for corn and soybeans. Here's a learning activity for you. This is our last slide, and just a summary as you're thinking about your farm as your environment. In the first box, I would like you to list, these are my environmental risks and concerns. So things that might be on your farm, a creek, a sensitive area, a slope of the ground. And on the other side of the page, we can write in another box, I will take these steps to minimize the risks. So think about what you might be able to do when you're applying pesticides to make sure that you're reducing risk to the environment, to the water, air, and the soil.